morning, everyone. How are you this morning? Got a little coolness in the air this morning, yeah? Well, it's good to see you and worship together today, and I want to welcome everyone who's joining online as well. Why don't you take a moment and let somebody know that you're glad to see them. Amen. Amen, amen. Well, today we'll continue chapter 2 of 1 Peter, focusing on verses 4 and 5 and a message called Building Blocks. And I chose that title because, as you'll quickly see, Peter's encouraging us to find the milk that we need to grow. Through chapter 1, Peter told us a lot about what God brings to those who place their faith in Christ. Things like the goodness of God and the mercy of God and the grace of God and the kindness that he pours out on us each and every day. And he told us that God chose us to be his children, and he cleansed us from our sins, and he made us holy, to name a few. And then he moved into telling us how this should affect the way that we live. Because basically, because we're God's children and we've been washed and clean and cleansed and made holy, it should cause us to want to act like God's children and live clean and holy. And then he reminded us of the high price that was paid to do this. It was the precious blood of the spotless Lamb of God. And that was meant to cause us to value the gift and the gift giver, and to communicate to your heart how much the Father values you. Because by his sacrifice, God changed our broken, dead relationship with him into a resurrected new life relationship built on love and on grace and not on fear and control. So God changed the basis of our relationship with him to love, and because he did, it changes the basis of our relationship with each other, right? That's why Peter told us, because you've been cleansed from our sins, now we can have sincere love for each other. Because before we were cleansed, our love was tainted by sin, like muddied water, right? But now that you've been purified, Peter encourages us to love each other intensely with all of our hearts. Truly loving each other shows that we've been delivered from the meaningless life that we inherited into a meaningful new life. And then last week, Peter encouraged us to completely reject the old ways of the old life, and he showed us that we can grow into the fullness of our salvation by crying out for the pure milk of God's word. Now today he's going to move into God's building blocks. So if you're ready, why don't we stand together and we're going to read 1 Peter 2 verses 4 through 5. Okay. Come to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by the people, but is precious to God who chose him. And now God is building you as living stones into his spiritual temple. What's more, you are God's holy priest who offers spiritual sacrifices that please him because of Jesus Christ. Tell somebody it's the word.
It's the word.
All right, go ahead and get comfortable. Peter begins with a heartfelt plea saying, come to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. Because when you come to Christ, it's a living, loving relationship built on his strength, on his strength. And I believe we'd be amiss to think that Peter's plea, come to Christ, is only meant for the unsaved. He most certainly is speaking to those who have never received Christ, because that's the universal cry of the gospel, come to Christ, right? Right? But I believe Peter's also calling the believers he's writing this letter to, because once you've come to Christ, you must continue coming closer. Draw nigh unto me and I will draw nigh unto you, says the Lord, right? Coming to Christ for the believer is the sanctification of our soul. It's the process of letting go of you and to become more of him, right? Like John the Baptist said, I must decrease that he might increase. Amen. So this plea is for each of us, saved and not yet saved. Whatever distance there is in our relationship, Peter is calling us to close the gap, right? Close the gap. This is an ongoing building project that protects us from falling away. In fact, this passage is referencing the fulfillment of an Old Testament prophecy found in Isaiah chapter 28. And in the background of that prophecy, it was given to Israel at a time when they had fallen away. Okay? They were so badly backslidden as a nation that they were about to go into captivity. In fact, God said it was so bad, Israel was being led by drunks. Even the priests and the prophets staggered from beer and wine, and they all made stupid mistakes, he said. So God was sending his true prophets to speak to them in very simple words to try to get them to understand and to turn to him. And because judgment was coming and God was extending a hand of grace so that if they would listen, they could avoid captivity by the Assyrians and remain in their land. But they thought they were slick. They thought they were slick and that by their cunning and their deception that they were protected from the Assyrians. So with that background, let's take a look at the prophecy in Isaiah 28. We're going to read verses 14 and 16 for now. Therefore, listen to this message from the Lord, you scoffing rulers in Jerusalem. You boast that you've struck a bargain to avoid death and have made a deal to dodge the grave. You say, the Assyrians can never touch us, for we have built a strong refuge made of lies and deception. Therefore, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Look, here's the prophecy, right? Look, I'm placing a foundation stone in Jerusalem. It is firm, a tested and precious cornerstone that is safe to build on. Whoever believes need never run away again. It's always amazing to me to look at prophecy fulfilled because it bolsters your confidence in the trustworthiness of what's yet to come, right? And there's a couple things I want to point out here to help us to understand this prophecy and how its fulfillment applies to our lives now. The first thing is that here we see God's people building on a foundation of lies and deception, right? Rather than turning to the Lord and doing things his way, then trusting him with their future, they took things into their own hands and they built the kind of life that comes when you separate from the Lord, right? The old ways, right? Their political leaders were all about partying and their priests and their prophets just became as corrupt as they did. And little by little over the years, the corruption grew deeper and deeper into their souls till it was so bad that God had to talk to them like little children because they had lost all spiritual sense. He was trying to save them from what their ways were bringing upon them, like war and running for their lives and captivity. Those things were right around the corner, but they were so blinded by their own deceit that they couldn't even see it coming. That's why the prophecy was given. Because when you build your life on the ways of the world, you're building on shifting sand. And so God spoke of the firm foundation stone who would become the cornerstone for all who would believe. And the promise is that when you build on him, you'll never have to run away again. Yeah. Let's look at what came next in verses 17 through 19. God says this. Remember, it was lies and deception. So he says this, I will take the measuring line of justice and the plumb line of righteousness to check the foundation wall you have built. Your refuge looks strong, but since it's made of lies, a hailstorm will knock it down. Since it's made of deception, the enemy will come in like a flood to sweep it away. I will cancel your bargain you made to avoid death, and I'll overturn your deal to dodge the grave. When the terrible enemy floods in, you will be trampled to the ground. Have you ever tried to warn someone that you cared about that they were heading down a dangerous path? I mean, like, you tell them and you tell them, but they just keep going because they think they're right or they believe that somehow they can escape the consequences that are inevitable. Maybe it's a teenager who isn't paying enough attention to their schoolwork or someone who's getting involved with drugs, or it could be a person who started dating with someone who's just full of drama, or maybe you tried to help a person who was just acted foolishly with their money, and you tried to help them learn to manage it properly. No matter what the case, when the person just keeps stubbornly heading for trouble, sometimes try as you may, you can't stop a fool in their folly, right? What we need to see in this passage is that even though they had turned away from God, he didn't turn away from them, right? He's still trying to speak good sense to them and point out point them to real strength, because this is a living relationship with a loving God. He can't just sit by and watch someone that he loves head for disaster and not get involved. They couldn't see it because they were blinded by their own foolishness, but the flood was coming. And what they built on wouldn't survive. So he's pointing them to the firm foundation, the same way you might point a financially foolish person to build on a budget, right? It's exactly what he's doing. See, when you come to Christ, you come to a living relationship. He's a God who cares, and he cares enough to get involved. He'll try to save you every way he can, even if he has to save you from yourself, right? This prophecy is the passage Jesus fulfilled. In Luke 6:46 through 49, he spoke about the firm foundation, saying this: "So why do you call me Lord when you won't obey me? I will show you what it's like when someone comes to me, listens to my teaching, and then obeys me. It's like a person who builds a house on a strong foundation laid upon underlying rock. When the floodwaters rise and break against the house, it stands firm because it was well built. But anyone who listens and doesn't obey is like a person who builds a house without a foundation. And when the floods sweep down against the house, it will crumble into a heap of ruins." Jesus spoke this at the end of his Sermon on the Mount when he gave us the Beatitudes. You remember the Beatitudes? They're maxims and parables explaining how to live this life the way that God intends, the way that God blesses, right? Yet when he said, "So why do you call me Lord when you won't obey me?" doesn't it sound like he's talking to the same kind of people that Isaiah was speaking to, right? He's reaching out to everyone, including those who are doing foolish things like the ones back in Isaiah. He's reaching out because it's a living relationship and he cares, right? He cares. That, like the people in Isaiah, some are so far gone in their folly that they weren't gonna do what he said. So the parable shows them that what is coming is destruction. Their life will become a heap of ruins. It's a warning. He does that in an effort to turn them away from their foolishness and into a life that God blesses, the life that God intends for the people that he loves. Maybe some turned to him. Maybe they did. I know once I was living a life of complete foolishness that was falling apart all around me. And in his great love, God never gave up on me, and he'll never give up on anyone. Right? He won't give up on you. Then one day by grace, I believed and I began to build differently because my ears were open to what Jesus was saying. The promise to those who build on the firm foundation is that when the floodwaters rise and they break against the house, it stands firm because it's well built. The prophecy in Isaiah said it similarly, saying, "You'll never have to run away again," right? He could have just as easily said, "You'll be able to stand firm," right? Right? Now, I'm sure this is not the first time anyone listening to me has heard Jesus' parable about the building, right? That's part of the reason why I've taken the time to put the entire thing into context so that we could grasp the nature of what's really happening. Floodwaters come into every house. They come into every house. Some hear the words Jesus speaks and foolishly don't pay attention, like Israel back in Isaiah's day. And like them, it leads to great loss and inevitable bondage. So at this point, a wise person will take stock of wisdom and consider what areas of life might need to be rebuilt on the firm foundation, because it would be blind foolishness to not make sure that you're on a firm foundation, right? I mean, I mentioned budgeting before. That's a firm foundation, right? Right? These are practical things, man. If we're just willy-nilly about how we deal with our money, guess what? It falls apart, doesn't it? Sure, yeah. See, God always tries to intervene before floodwaters come because it's a living, loving relationship. But only those who build on the firm foundation will be left standing, because when you come to Christ, it's a living, loving relationship that's built on his strength. See, we don't have to do it in our own strength. It's built on his strength. It's a living relationship. And because it's a living relationship, no matter what floods come at you, God is always showing you how to build to stand firm. Right? God wants you to come close. That's why Peter says, come to Christ, because God wants you to he wants to show us how to build firm. He'll show you how to build firm in your faith, in your courage, in your honesty, in your health, in your finances, in your marriage, in your parenting, in your education, in your investments, in your friendships. He'll show you how to build firm in your prayer life, in your knowledge of him, in your faithfulness, in your holiness, in your joy, in your peace, in your confidence, in your career, and in your goals. And he'll show you how to build firm in your ministry, in your compassion, in your giving, in your endurance, in your gentleness, in your patience, in your kindness, your self-control, and in your love. See, you have to build firm if you want to stand, and he'll show you how to build firm in your life, because it's a living, loving relationship built on strength. Those are the building blocks for life that God wants us to have, because those are the building blocks that will stand firm. So go ahead and encourage someone. Tell them, build firm so you'll stand. Amen. Next, Peter moves from the building block of Christ to the cornerstone. To the cornerstone that the living stones are set on. And he says this, he says, and now God is building you as living stones into his spiritual temple. Because when you come to Christ, God builds you into a living temple. As I said earlier, the prophecy of Isaiah was given at a time when Israel was extremely backslidden. And it's a warning meant to bring them back so they could remain in their land. But they didn't heed any of God's warnings. And in the end, they were taken captive and Jerusalem itself was destroyed. Yet, God in his sovereignty eventually brought them back. And this happened in several waves over decades of time. But the second wave was led by a man named Nehemiah, who was tasked with rebuilding the walls because they had been completely torn down. So the city and anyone who would try to repopulate the city were completely exposed to the danger of many hostile enemies. It was a daunting and a dangerous task because the workers were comparatively few for the size of the task that was ahead, and the opposition was great because many enemies didn't want to allow them to achieve that state of safety with a walled city. However, it did get accomplished. And in a very short time, primarily because God was in it, right? See, when God's in it, it happens. But secondarily, because the people really wanted to do what God wanted them to. See, when our heart's in what God wants us to do, God gets behind it and helps us to achieve it and to succeed in building the way that he wants us to build, right? So it's a good place to see this is Nehemiah 4:6. It says, so we built the wall, and the entire wall was joined together up to half its height, for the people had a mind to work, right? That means they had aligned themselves with God's will. Nehemiah was the project leader, and what he did was he gave everybody a place on the wall, right? I mean, every family would take a portion according to their size and number and their ability. The Levites had their section, the priests had their section, and so on and so forth. Every single person had a place on the wall and stones to place in the wall, right? Repopulating Jerusalem was God's redemption for his people from their former sins of turning their back on it. He is a merciful God, man. And when we mess up, God's always extending that hand of mercy and grace and giving us opportunities to rebuild right, you know? Yeah. Once the wall was completed, then they were able to turn their attention to rebuilding the temple, which was actually the primary thing. But see, they needed the walls up first because previously when they tried to rebuild the temple, their enemies stopped them over and over and over again. See, the temple was the primary thing needed for the future of the people. That's what we build. We build our life on God, right? That's what our future's built on. It was the primary thing needed for the future of people because it was the place of worship to the living God. Their worship unified them. It set them apart from other people. It brought them back into covenant relationship with God. And it's in that covenant relationship that they would survive and once again thrive because the hand of God would bless them as a people and as a nation. Anybody want the hand of God blessing your life and your family and your community and your schools and the place and where you're employed? Yeah? Amen. Now, see, I share all that to give us a picture of what God is doing in and through us today. Peter said, now God is building you as living stones into his spiritual temple. God is placing us as living stones on the living foundation of Christ, the cornerstone. And just as everybody had a building place on the walls of Jerusalem, each person has a building place in the temple God is building now. And just what is that temple? I'm glad you asked. Turn to Ephesians 2:20. Ephesians 2:20 through 22. Somebody say, we are his house. Built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, and the cornerstone is Christ Jesus himself. We who believe are carefully joined together, becoming a holy temple for the Lord. Through him, you Gentiles are also joined together as a part of this dwelling where God lives by his Spirit. We're the temple he's building on planet Earth today. We're the dwelling where God lives by his Spirit. We're the living stones. And since Galatians 3:18 tells us that there's no longer Jew or Gentile, slave or free, male or female, for all our Christians, you are one in Christ. We know that God's special people are no longer only the Jews, right? You're God's special people today, right? Amen. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Tell somebody God wants everyone. And what that means is each person has a way to contribute to the work of God being done in the world. We all have a place on the wall, right? The temple in Jerusalem was the center of spiritual learning and worship. Spiritual knowledge and true worship were protected. They were secured, and they were retained, while heresy and defilement were repelled. Right? It's a place. You know, sometimes we have to watch over and protect these things. We can't let the world come in and influence what the Word of God says. We have to keep it as pure milk, like Peter was telling us. Right? The temple was the place that God inhabited. Levites guarded it, and they assisted the priests who served God by serving the people. Right, the sacrifices came to fulfillment through Christ, because he was one sacrifice for all time. Right, he's the great high priest. Now we assist him by serving people. Right, that means we serve the ones who are currently a part of his temple and the ones who are still lost that he gave his life for. And we do that by shining the light of Christ through our life and by sharing the gospel of Christ in every opportunity that he gives us. Now notice Peter said God is building you. It's an active and ongoing process, right? You're living stones, and you're things that are constantly are evolving. Think about your body for a minute. You know, vital organs always do the same thing, right? They do it all the time, but the person continues to evolve. Your eyes constantly see new things. Your ears constantly hear new sounds, new words, and new dialogue. Our feet take us to new places and new experiences. Your hands learn new skills, and all that causes your mind to grow and you to evolve as a person, right? We are living stones, right? And as stones, we have a place on the foundation, but as living stones, it's even better. Because one thing about being a stone in the wall of Jerusalem is that the stones got cemented in, right? Once they were placed, they were stuck right there. That's where they were going to stay, right? But as living stones placed by God, that place can evolve too. Meaning, you're not stuck. You're not stuck. There's many ways God can use you as a living stone right here in his church. We are all his building blocks, right? But you're a living stone, and living stones evolve. Last week when the worship team came to rehearse, I saw our drummer, Ethan. He was over at the keyboard playing. And I just smiled at him, and I said, man, I didn't know that you were learning to play the keyboard, you know? And he looked back at me, and he just smiled and said, yeah, I am. He's growing. He's evolving. Maybe one day he'll evolve so much that he becomes a worship leader, right? He's not stuck. Everybody has a place to serve God, and we're living stones. You're his spiritual temple, and he's building you as a part of that temple. He's building you, and he's building you into the temple. You're a living stone that's meant to grow, learn, and evolve. You're not meant to be stuck. See, we all have a place to serve, and we all have a God who's building us. So tell somebody, you're not stuck. Amen. Next, Peter tells us a little about how God is building, saying this. He says, what's more, you're God's holy priest who offer spiritual sacrifices that please him because of Christ. And that's beautiful because it informs us when you come to Christ, you're built into something that pleases God. That pleases God. Sometimes I'm just very, very aware of how messed up I am. Anybody else ever, you know? And you just think, man, I don't know how God could, I don't know how God could love me. I don't know how God could be pleased. We are built into something that pleases God. I mean, you are in Christ, and being in Christ makes you pleasing to God. It's his design, and by this design, we please him because the sacrifice of Christ makes us more than acceptable. Tell somebody you're more than acceptable. See, this idea of being pleased to God is connected to verse 4 where he says, he was rejected by the people. He, Christ, was rejected by the people. But he is precious to God who chose him. He is precious to God. See, this universe had nothing more valuable to build this temple on than Christ, right? Precious. Christ and Christ alone was selected by God to be the cornerstone because he is complete perfection. But get this. Only complete perfection could be satisfactory to a God who's perfect. But in Christ, we enter into that perfection and we become likewise pleasing to God. Isn't that great? It's built into what you're built into. That's pretty cool, right? To get our head around that a little bit better, let's take a look at our function. As living stones built into the temple of Christ, God has made us his holy priests, right? Isn't that what we just read? His holy priests. Now, the priests in the temple were responsible for presenting the offerings of the people before the Lord, and those offerings They looked forward to Christ, the perfect Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, right? That's what the offerings were about. And that brought an end. When Christ came, it brought an end to the need for further sacrifices. As Hebrews 9:12 says, once for all time, he took the blood into that most holy place, but not the blood of goats and calves. He took his own blood, and with it secured our salvation forever, right? Secured forever. So this role the priests had of offering sacrifices, it's been completed because Jesus secured our salvation forever, right? It's finished. It's been done. It's complete. It's secure. Nothing can ever change it. It can't be canceled out or undone, not by you or anyone. No matter how good you are, you can't improve upon it. And no matter how bad you are, you cannot diminish it. Once for all time, Christ secured your salvation forever, right? Amen. Somebody ought to say, thank you, Lord. Amen. So the job of offering sacrifices no longer applies because our great high priest completed it. Then what are the spiritual sacrifices we offer and what makes them pleasing to God? See, the priest also offered prayers for the people and the prayers of the people to God. Those prayers of the people were represented by the special incense that they burned in the holy place. Now only the priests were permitted to offer this special incense. And incense had to be prepared in a specific manner according to the precise directions of God. Anything that was not prepared that way was considered strange incense, and it couldn't be offered before the Lord. So this specific incense prepared in a very particular manner represented the prayers of God's holy people. And when offered, it became a sweet and pleasant aroma to God. That's what the scripture says. I stress that to say It was the incense mixed with the prayers that made the prayers sweet, because the incense also symbolized Christ's atoning death, which is perfect to God. See, here's what you got to see. Christ was in the prayers. Tell somebody, Christ is in the prayers. Peter said, God made us his holy priests who offer spiritual sacrifices that are pleasing to him. Those spiritual sacrifices are at least in part our prayers. But we don't have special incense, right? And we certainly don't know how to pray perfect prayers before God. And this very thing makes prayer intimidating for many people, because they feel like they don't really know how to pray properly, or even if what they're praying for is something that God would want. Anybody relate? Yeah, sure. Not to worry, you my beautiful living stones, because you're being built into God's holy temple, and he's already built the perfection into it. It's already built in. Take a look at Romans 8. 26 and 27. And the Holy Spirit helps us in our distress, for we don't even know what we should pray for, nor how we should pray. Can anybody relate? But the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that can't be expressed in words. And the Father, who knows all hearts, knows what the Spirit is saying. For the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. That's amazing. See, when you pray, the Holy Spirit prays with you and prays for you, taking your prayer and perfectly aligning it with God's own will. It's built in. It's built in. Christ is in your prayers through the Holy Spirit. The priest prayed for the people, and Christ was in it. Praying for others is a spiritual sacrifice. And as God's holy priest, we're called to offer those prayers. But God doesn't leave us to do this in our own ability, with our own imperfections. Our prayers are pleasing to God because of Christ. It was his atoning work that cleansed you, so that in him you've been made perfect. Being cleansed, you became the temple of the Holy Spirit, who now lives in you and knows everything about you. He understands the depths of your heart, your deepest desires, what you really want, what you really mean, and what you're really trying to say. He gets it. He also knows the depths of God's heart and what he wants for you, and what he wants for the people that you pray for and for the entire world. So when you pray, he intercedes on your behalf to make your prayer perfectly aligned with God's heart, so that your prayer is in harmony with God's own will, and it becomes a sweet and beautiful aroma to God. Isn't that amazing? See, now you can be free from worry when you pray, right? You don't have to be intimidated, because the Holy Spirit is right there with you, taking your prayer and making it a perfect prayer that's pleasing to God. Because of the sacrifice of Christ, you are pleasing to God. Because of the sacrifice of Christ, you have become holy priests. Because of the sacrifice of Christ, the Holy Spirit helps you when you pray. Because of the sacrifice of Christ, you can offer up spiritual sacrifices that please God. Because of the sacrifice of Christ, you can be free from fear, and you can pray with confidence. You are God's chosen people. Peter already told us this. He said the Spirit has made you holy. You've been cleansed by his blood. God's special favor and wonderful peace is on your life. You've been given the privilege of being born again. You have a wonderful expectation because Christ rose from the dead, and you have a priceless inheritance kept pure for you in heaven, and by his mighty power, God is protecting you until you receive it. So now you can be truly glad, because you have wonderful joy in your future, and God will use every trial that you face while you're on this earth to build and to purify your faith, so it's going to bring you much praise and glory. And your reward for trusting Jesus is the salvation of your soul. So now you can be happy with an inexpressible joy. What God is doing in your life is so amazing. Even the angels in heaven are eagerly watching God pouring out his wonderful goodness on you. And because your sins have been cleansed, now you can have sincere love for each other as brothers and sisters. And you've been delivered from the empty old life that you inherited into a new meaningful life that lasts forever. And because of Christ, You can grow into the fullness of your salvation. And because of Christ, you have become a living stone that God is building into his spiritual temple. You are God's building blocks, and God is building you at the same time. Take a moment and encourage somebody. Tell them God is building you. Amen.
Good word. You know, as I'm listening to the building blocks, I'm thinking back on my time growing up with Legos. You know, and I had Legos growing up, and my kids inherited a whole bunch of Legos. They had buckets of Legos. And when you play Legos, you got to dig in because there's so much. And, you know, God is building us, but we got to dig in. You know, there's so much that he wants to do in our lives, but we got to dig in. And as you're digging in, realize that, you know, there are going to be some traps in life. You know, I like to play golf. And sometimes a lot of times I end up in the trap. I end up in the sand trap. And when you get in the sand trap, you got to dig in. You got to move your feet and dig in so that you have a stable foundation so you can get out of that trap. And when we're being built by God, there are going to be traps in our lives. But we got to dig in because God is building you. Amen? Amen. Good word. Thank you, Pastor Mike. Couple announcements to share. We will resume children's ministry and Crossroads Youth next week. So looking forward to that. So the children can be ministered to by our wonderful workers who are giving their lives as God builds them to serve others. Amen. And another announcement, our journey groups are back in session. So looking forward to that midweek to be able to just get together and encourage each other in God's word as he's building us. Amen. Please stand. I'd like to say a prayer blessing over you, my family, my friends. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious towards you. May the Lord give you his favor and show you his peace. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Bless the Lord. Amen.